Okay. Hi, folks. My name's Bill Drislane, and I've worked at Dragon since like April of 2011. And tonight's talk is going to be on quality and test design. And we've got a smaller crew tonight, so if anybody has questions, please speak up. I'm hoping a few people have some problems or situations they want to discuss that we could use as examples for the purpose of tonight's talk. So first, I'd like to take a quick survey. Who here has ever conducted anything that they would call as a quality or a test activity in support of a design or in support of production? Okay.
Website.
Okay. Well, the principles are the same. Okay. And so then we're going to talk about what quality is and how you achieve it. We're going to have an intermission. Then we'll talk about, have a briefer talk on test design and test strategy. So I already did the survey. So what's quality? What do you guys think quality is?
Should meet specs.
Okay, meet specs. What else?
Reliably meet specs.
Okay, reliability. Anything else? That has a lot of meanings. Come on, Errol, this should be easy for you.
Yeah, I would look at it as like repeatability and control.
Okay, all of a sort of a similar vein. There's other meanings. One of the most common is, does it meet the customer's expectations? And this is important because you can make a widget and build it beautifully to you know, tight tolerances, and it's a thing of beauty and nobody wants it. You know, the customer's not happy with it. Or the customer doesn't understand how to use it and uses it wrong and is therefore unhappy with it. So that's one definition. Manufacturing base, which is what you guys were all addressing, you know, was the part made to print? Did it pass all its tests? Or product base, where it has a quality, has something nobody else has. This laptop has tail fins and nobody else's has. This is a quality of that product. Or value based in terms of the best bang for the buck, the features you get at a given price point. And perhaps last and sometimes most important is the, sort of the ooh-ah factor, what people will call transcendent quality. So that when you're at the movie theater, as I was last weekend, and they're showing 80 feet high, the latest, I can't remember if it's LG or Samsung phone, all gleaming chrome and matte black and beautiful photography. And all the appeal has nothing to do at all with how well it makes a phone call. It's all about how sexy it is as a piece of jewelry. And so that's transcendent quality, and that can be really important. Okay, let's talk about some of the negative attributes of failing to meet quality requirements. One is safety, of course. And an example I like to use is the early days of the M16 rifle, which was put into production not long after the Vietnam War started, so very late 60s, I think. And the M16 was a wonderful rifle for its time. Could be very cheaply manufactured, was very lightweight, was extremely accurate, much more accurate than, for example, an AK-47. The problem was it was made with very tight tolerances, and if you got so much as a speck of dust in there, it would jam. And in 1978, when I was a cadet at West Point, I had an M16, and we used to go out and maneuvers in the field and use blanks so you don't hurt anybody. And blanks foul up the rifle because all there's the powder and the wadding and everything they use. And I spent half my life cleaning that rifle, just tearing it down and cleaning it, because you just look at it cross-eyed and it would jam. And an example that's cited, and you can find this example similar to this in many places of soldiers in Vietnam found dead with plenty of ammunition and a jammed rifle. Or in this example, desperately trying to strip it down and clear the jam before getting killed. Another great example, the Ford Pinto gas tank problem. Back in, I want to say, the early 70s, when the Japanese were beginning to eat the American automakers' lunch, because oil and gas prices had risen very quickly, and the latest iron from Detroit would do at best 15 miles to the gallon, and the Japanese were bringing in inexpensive little cars that would do, what for the time was amazing gas mileage of 25 miles to the gallon. Folks like Ford and Chevy rushed small cars into production, and so you had those disasters known as the Pinto and the Vega on Chevy's part. And the Pinto had a problem with the gas tank. One of the mounting brackets on the gas tank was mounted in such a way that in a rear end, if the vehicle was stuck from the rear end, the bracket would tear loose from the tank and rip the tank open, spill the entire contents of the gas tank right on the road. And this was known before they went into production. They had a meeting. They decided it would cost $11 to change the design and retrofit parts already made, and they decided it would be cheaper to pay the insurance claims. And they went ahead, and it was a disaster. There were a number of very spectacular fires. At least 27 people were killed, and most of them burned to death. And there were tons of lawsuits, and just one typical lawsuit awarded $6 million. They had to recall and repair 2 million vehicles, so all in all, this thing probably cost $500 million to deal with, and that was in the mid-70s when a dollar was worth a lot more than it is today. So obviously a pretty short-sighted decision on Ford's part. Okay, economics. An example I like to use, say you're working at a consumer products company and they do $100 million a year in sales, and they make 10% on the bottom line before taxes, which is actually pretty good for a retail company. And they budget a 5% allowance for consumer returns, and the return rate is actually 15%. And this is pretty much what happened to us in the early days at iRobot. Return rate was 15% instead of a more normal 5% for consumer product. And so what that means is that 10% profit you had just went to zero. And zero doesn't mean that the company gets along. Zero means layoffs and downsizing and unhappiness for all. So in fact, in many ways, quality and reliability is perhaps the single most easily influenced cost that impacts the bottom line. Once you've got a product into mass production and you've optimized it, there's not very many more pennies you can get out of it. But 10% off the sales by dealing with quality issues is a pretty important improvement. Okay, we just listed a lot of negatives that happen when you don't do it right. There are a lot of positives when you do it right. And so you think of brands that represent high quality to you, whether it's in cars, Toyota or Mercedes or BMW or Apple or Google with phones, FedEx and DHL when you're shipping a package. And so the appeal of their brand really hinges upon the quality of their products. And so these people live and die by maintaining that reputation for quality. And as a result of it, they get much higher margins on their products. So Apple gets huge margins on their phones, much more so than an awful lot of Android manufacturers. And it's because of the quality of their product. And quality defined more generally, as in that list we looked at earlier in the discussion, not just reliability, et cetera, but that ooh-ah factor that makes people desire that particular phone. Okay. A very important concept, design is ultimate constraint. This means if you release a crappy product into manufacturing, there's nothing manufacturing can do to make it rise above that. They can make it be as good as your design, but generally no better unless they set out to redesign it, and you'd hope that they can't do as good a job of designing it as you can if you're the design engineer, because if they can, then there might be some job changes in your future. This is perhaps more appropriate for a large company. We could retitle it and say succeeding despite yourself or despite organizational dynamics. And it's an important question because in all the examples I've given so far, anybody with a sixth grade education would have known to do the right thing. There was no rocket science involved. You didn't have to be Albert Einstein to know that going into production with 2 million vehicles with a gas tank that tears open when you hit the car from behind. How smart do you have to be to know what the right thing to do is? These people didn't fail because they weren't smart enough. They failed because they made the wrong decisions, and those wrong decisions came about because of organizational dynamics. And a great example for that is the Challenger disaster back in 1986. Just a quick review of why it happened. The solid fuel boosters are made in sections because they're too big to make in one piece. The sections are sealed with two O-rings. The O-rings have to hold in gas at pressures up to several thousand PSI and very, very high temperatures. And on the Challenger, the high-pressure gas managed to burn through both O-rings, and naturally, it was on the side towards the giant hydrogen-oxygen fuel tank, and the jet of high-temperature gas played against the tank right at the junction between the hydrogen and oxygen tanks until eventually, boom. Big explosion. And that happened at, I think, about 80,000 feet, and the remains of the orbiter continued to coast up to, I think it was about 120,000 feet, and the fall all the way back down to the ocean. It took about 10 minutes. And they know from analyzing what they found that at least a couple of the astronauts survived and were alive all the way to impact, although probably not conscious. So you think, so how did this happen? There were two O-rings on that booster, and it was designated a criticality one component. This meant that the backup O-ring is not allowed, you're not allowed to expect to use it. That is, a failure of the first O-ring is considered a failure, and any evidence of a failure is supposed to result in a shutdown of the program until the problem's fixed. It had happened several times, and they chose not to shut the program down to fix it. And though the two times it happened, two or three times, were both under benign conditions, no reason to think that the O-ring was any more stressed than at any other time. Excuse me. And yet they continue to launch because they'd gotten away with it so far, so they continue to launch. For the night before the Challenger launch, temperature in southern Florida reached 18 Fahrenheit. It was 31 degrees at the time of the launch. And there's great pictures of all the superstructure of the rocket, everything else covered in just sheets of ice, thick ice. So it obviously had been very cold. Those O-rings, you know, after having been cold soaked all night, were probably somewhere in the 20s. The material, there was no data on the performance of the O-ring compound below 53 Fahrenheit. And the solid fuel booster manufacturer had said that it should not be used below 40 Fahrenheit. I don't know where they got permission to go 13 degrees lower, but they did. So here they're looking at this, they're making the launch decision, and they've gone way below the parameters that they'd established as being reasonably safe. And we know, because several had burned through before, almost burned through, that it was still wasn't safe despite that. And so they had discussions. In particular, an engineer at Morton Thiokol was being stubborn and saying, you can't launch. It's not safe. We don't know if this will deal with it. Every time you scrub a launch, it costs some number of millions of dollars because you've got all the labor, all the people, you've got to defuel, take down all the hydrogen and oxygen, deal with it safely, take the, you know, truck everything back to the vehicle assembly building, take everything apart. And so it's a big, big deal. And NASA didn't want to spend the money, and they didn't want the stain on their record of scrubbing a launch. So they put a lot of pressure on Morton Thiokol management, who put a lot of pressure on the engineer, who finally caved. So they launched. And, you know, the rest is history. And so you got to ask, first of all, you know, what were they thinking? How could they make such a decision when it had already nearly failed several times previously on otherwise balmy Florida days? Anybody want to make any speculation, or have you read about it?
No, I just know it was pretty cold. I was in Georgia that morning. We didn't go to school because it was too cold.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyone ever hear of a concept called groupthink? Do you know what that is? You're nodding your head more than other people.
Yeah, sure. It's the concept of, for instance, in brainstorming, it can be negative in that you kind of attract towards one idea, and it seems safer to go with that idea. And so people more often than not do so.
Yeah, you're hardwired to agree with a group. You know, we evolved that way so that groups would be cohesive and would function well. But it hurts you, as in a case like this. And you have to, that Morton Thiokol engineer who finally caved in the end, you got to wonder, you know, how he feels about it later. You know, if he'd been a little more stubborn. Or if some of the other engineers in the room had stood up and supported him. Because it wouldn't take very many people to break the groupthink. Because once people feel there's even a large minority opposed, they're going to be uncertain. But when there's a majority, people feel they can be safe and then go along with it. You've heard you never get fired for buying IBM, even if the IBM purchase turned out to be a disaster, because that's what everybody does and it's acceptable. So you just did what everybody else did and you were okay.
But it's also about management policy that you really need people from the top to be extremely concerned about these things. Mm-hmm. I mean, you see it over and over in the financial industry or BP disaster or whatever. There's mm-hmm. just management pressure to get certain things done.
Yeah. Well, NASA had made, at the beginning of the shuttle program, a lot of promises about how cheap it would be to operate and how quick the turnaround would be. And it all turned out to be a lot of smoke and mirrors. It turned out to be way more expensive than the throwaway boosters they used to use. The turnaround time was really long. You think about it. You've got a vehicle that has to be reused over a period of 25 years. What level of maintenance do you have to do to maintain that kind of reliability? It's pretty high, and that's labor intensive. If, on the other hand, the rocket's just going to fire for 10 minutes and it's going to crash into the ocean, never to be seen again, things are a little easier and you can still achieve the same level of reliability. So NASA was under all this pressure. There's also something that happens, and it probably has a name and I've forgotten, which is the idea that you take successively larger chances and you get away with it, so it reinforces that it's okay. And you see this often in people who climb in the Himalayas, where over the years, increasingly more aggressive and faster climbing styles, where people strip down, very light pack, you know, no longer siege style with tents and oxygen, and they'll ascend and descend K2 in 24 hours. You know, these guys are superb athletes, but they're not even carrying a sleeping bag. If they got caught in a storm, they're dead. and they do it successively more aggressive attempts until finally it kills them, but they don't learn from that lesson because they're dead. And so this is probably what happened with those O-rings. It partly burned through, but it was okay. It burned through a little more, but we're still okay, and so on and so forth. There were other problems with NASA culture. At NASA, when you bucked the group consensus, you know, you suffered, your career suffered for it. And this is probably another thing, you know, the weight on the minds of the people in that meeting.
This is true in nearly every company that I've ever worked at. Yeah, no one wants to be the guy that's always complaining.
Yeah, well, you know, if you're that guy from Morton Thiokol, you got to say to yourself, I'm willing to lose my job to do the right thing. And that's unfortunate, but true. It's how human beings are wired. Okay, so off the depressing stuff and on to, you know, how do we meet quality requirements? You know, you got to design it right, because it'll never be better than the design. So you got to anticipate all possible uses. I have a circular saw, and I once went through the manual, and of the 12 pages in the manual, 10 are all page after page of do not use underwater, do not use hanging from a trapeze, you know, you name it, they tell not to do it. There's absolutely no instruction on how to do a good job with it, you know, how to make a clean cut, for example. You've got to think about inadvertent or unintended effects of the product. You know, and there's umpteen examples from the pharmaceutical industry. Just think of thalidomide, for example. When you're thinking about problems and you have to decide what to do about a problem, you have to look at severity, and this is pretty obvious. Will it kill somebody? Does it just look like it will kill somebody? Which, by the way, both legally and under the opinion of the Consumer Product Safety Commission, is very nearly almost as bad as actually killing someone. A product perceived to be dangerous is just as vulnerable to a recall as one that actually is dangerous, or whether it only causes property damage or just an irritation. Also, the likelihood, and again, this is pretty obvious. You know, if a toaster oven has a 1 in 10 million chance of burning a house down, you may find that acceptable, because the chance will never be zero, and as a corporation, you have to decide how much money you'll put into making that toaster oven be safe. One that people don't often think about is something called detectability, which is the hazard apparent to the user. And for example, take a knife. You sell knives. When you buy a sharp knife from a kitchen supply store, it doesn't have a fluorescent orange handle. It doesn't have a retractable guard. It doesn't come with a 12-page manual saying do not this and do not that, because everybody knows what a knife is. You bought it because it's sharp. The hazard is apparent. And if you cut yourself with it and tried to sue someone, the judge would laugh you out of the courtroom. But let's say you're making a vacuum cleaner, and the housing is two plastic halves that screw together, and the handle is formed by the two halves, and the molds are getting old and worn, and there's some flash on the underside of the handle, nice sharp knife edge flash, but you can't see it. And so you pick it up and bam, slices your hand, maybe severs a tendon. That's a hidden hazard, and that, you know, if that person sues, they can get punitive damages, make a lot of money, because the hazard is not apparent. I give one example. A company I worked for at one time, Europro, made garment steamers, among other things. And one of their competitors built a garment steamer which used a pressurized boiler, which is common. And when you operated the trigger operates a valve that allows the steam to come out. And they put the valve actually right there in the handle, in such a place where if the pressure relief valve failed and the pressure built up until the hose popped off the fitting, steam at well over 212, because it's pressurized, would blast right down onto your hand. And so they got raked over the coals. So the people who were at least marginally smarter, like us, the switch was just wired to a relay and the valve was down in the base, and there were two layers of protection between your hand and the steam tube. And the steam tube passing near your hand was after the valve, so it was always at room temperature anyways, atmospheric pressure. So this is something people don't often realize, and it's very important to think about, is the hazard apparent. And this is why also, for example, if you build a product and if you label the product appropriately so the hazards are clearly marked, the worst thing that can happen to you in court is that you get sued for actual damages. So I burn myself, I have a $20,000 medical bill, you might get hit with that. If you didn't warn them, if it was a hidden hazard, then you leave it open for punitive damages and willful negligence and so on. So very important to warn and inform. Okay, acceptable level of hazard. Let's say you're shipping 3 million toaster ovens a year, you're running this one company. What risk of fire are you willing to take? So you're going to make a decision. Do I spend an extra $0.92 to put a second thermal cutoff device in series with the first one in case the first one fails, and they do sometimes. You know, what's your acceptable level of risk? I'm putting you on the spot. You're the CEO. Zero is not possible. NASA can't deliver you a toaster oven with zero. It can be very small if you spend a lot of money, but if you spend too much money, nobody will buy it and you go bankrupt.
One in a thousand per percent.
So one in 100,000? Per year or per toaster oven?
0.001% risk. If zero is not possible,
So one out of 100,000, if you ship 3 million a year, that's 30 toaster ovens a year catching fire. Okay. So that would result in a return. You'd get in a lot of trouble.
What's the severity? I mean, you've told us that the toaster oven catches fire, but what happens after that?
It depends on what the user does with it. If they put it in a cabinet and stack towels on top of it, and this has been done, then you're likely to set the house on fire. If everyone does what the manual says and put it in the counter, you have at least 6 inches of space around and 8 above or something like that, then not much will happen other than setting off the smoke alarm.
So you can warn against that, right? So you can warn, don't put it in the cabinet and don't encroach upon it. But if it still catches fire, then in that case, the profit margins on this are probably pretty small, right? So you'd want to come out ahead after a couple of losses.
Well, they're like most consumer products. You're selling to a wholesaler, you're going to be marking it up, 60 to 80% over your manufacturing cost. So 30 or 40% contribution margin selling to wholesale. By the time you've factored in returns and advertising copays and so on. I mean this less as an exercise in economics and more as an exercise in how you look at these things, because I don't know about you, but as I was VP of quality at Europro and was director of quality at iRobot, and I really didn't give a rat's ass about the economics. I didn't want to come into work one day and find out some little kid burned to death in his bed because I didn't do something right. That's really the important thing to me. I find when we do this in large groups, the group tends to converge, just like we were talking about earlier, and we get, usually people are willing to accept a 1 in 10 chance of a house fire per year, given however many products they ship. But there's no right answer, right?
Yeah.
Okay, couple of things. Intrinsic safety, and the toaster oven is actually a bad example for setting houses on fire. If the bimetallic thermostat, which is how they control the temperature, contacts weld on, which is how they fail, how hot do you think it gets? You set the timer for 2 hours and the contacts weld on and you go away. So it runs for a couple hours. What do you think the equilibrium temperature is?
800 F.
Anybody else? 450. It's just the maximum temperature on the dial. So in fact, it can fail on and it doesn't create any hazardous condition. And the timer will time out after a while and shut the toaster oven down anyways. So in fact, a toaster oven is, unless the owner does something really stupid like stacks the towels on top of it, which like I said, doesn't happen, it's intrinsically safe.
Oh, so when you have it max on.
Yeah. And we had a problem with a bad batch of thermostats at Europro where they were all welding on. Not a single customer ever complained that the toaster oven didn't control its temperature. None of them. And I remember getting a return for some other reason, and the note the woman included with it said, "This is the best toaster oven I've ever had. Everything I cook in it comes out beautiful." And the contacts had been welded on forever. So she was cooking cakes, I think it was a rolling oven. She was making cakes, it had a rotisserie arrangement in it. She was, roasting little small chickens and so on. Never noticed. So that's a good example of intrinsic safety. And as a result, it took that thing maybe 25 or 30 minutes to equilibrate up at 450. It heated up pretty slow. But now take a coffee maker. Are you willing to wait 30 minutes for the water to boil when you want coffee in the morning?
Well, you also don't want to wait 30 minutes to get a piece of actual toast out of the toaster.
Yeah, well, they also explained why they were lousy toasters. And they are, for the most part. But a coffee maker, nobody's going to wait 20 minutes for their first cup of coffee. Coffee makers are really powerful, and their equilibrium temperature is off the scale. So if a so now where a toaster oven rarely causes a house fire, coffee makers have a much higher chance of doing it. As a result, the all the codes require that they have not one but two thermal cutoffs in series, because thermal cutoffs can occasionally, rarely, but occasionally fail on, and then you have no more safety. So you have to have two. And the smart engineer buys them from different manufacturers and uses fundamentally different methods, because there's a couple different ways to make them. So that's an example where you have an intrinsically dangerous product, and you layer on safeties for it. When I do this talk at Olin, I give the kids an exercise, and we take them through four levels of coffee pot development. No TCO, two TCOs, software, power. Finally, in the end, we have two TCOs plus the ability of a microprocessor that can monitor current and voltage and temperature and can shut things down and does a power on self-test. And this is the NASA coffee pot. At that point, if you built a million coffee pots, it would take longer than the age of the universe to have one failure on average. So you never get to zero, but you can get pretty darn close.
But that sounds like there's government regulation which is making sure that everyone has to use the same quality to some degree.
Well, it's a minimum. Says you have to, I'm not even sure it's a government regulation. Once you have once you get into regulatory certifications, it's actually kind of shocking how few things the government actually regulates. And coffee pots are mostly designed to UL standards. UL is a voluntary standard. Nobody makes you use it. Now, no retailer will stock your product unless it has a UL or ETL tag on it. And a consumer that has half a brain won't buy it either. So for all practical purposes, you want to sell an AC-powered appliance in this country, you've got to get UL or ETL on it. Okay. Another example. I had, this happened to me personally, I had a power surge at home, and I had a charger for this is an old device, a NiCad battery-equipped electric weed whacker. And the power supply melted down, and the battery melted down. Luckily, it didn't catch fire, but I had a bunch of molten plastic on my hands. If that charger had used a multi-voltage power supply, which now aren't that much more expensive than the cheap ones that aren't multi-voltage, wouldn't have happened. So, and then I wanted to talk about redundancy and what I call fake redundancy. A good example of fake redundancy is on an aircraft I used to own, a Grumman Tiger. There's a switch, actually two switches, to give power to your radios. And it's the avionics master. And it's a very important function, because if you lose your radios, you know, then you can't communicate, and if you're in instrument conditions, really you're probably dead at that point. So that switch is a single point of failure for something that is otherwise redundant everywhere, because you have at least two separate radios, two separate nav radios. They all have their own wiring, their own circuit breakers, their own everything. They only come together with that one switch. So they routinely give you two switches wired in parallel. So even if one fails, you can turn the other on. Most people, when they fly, they power up the aircraft, they turn on the electrical master, and they turn on the avionics master, take their finger and do this. And at the end of the day, when they're done, they take their finger and do that. So they flip both switches at one time. So if one of the switches failed open, would they know it? So then eventually when the second switch fails open, what happens? You know, they're toast, maybe. Okay, it does extend the life. If you assume an exponential failure distribution, it extends the life 41%. But, you know, it's your life that's in the balance. On the other hand, if you take it, when you turn it on, this is what I used to do, is you flip off one switch and then the other, listening for when the radios turn on, and when you turn it off, you flip off one and then the other, then you'll detect one switch fails. What has to happen to get in trouble is for both switches to fail in the course of one flight. And that's an extremely small probability. So that's true redundancy, but flipping them on and off at the same time is fake redundancy. It improves the life, but not dramatically. And this is where power on self-test and any product that can do it is so powerful, where it runs through everything, and that's what we have in the NASA coffee pot. You turn the power on, you have a relay that the microprocessor controls, and you also have a solid-state device that's controlled by the temperature regulator, and you set the temperature to below room temperature, turn on the relay and see if power goes on. That tells you if the FET failed on, which they will do. And you do routines like this. You have to have the FET fail and the relay fail and both TCOs fail all in the course of making a pot of coffee, which is what, you know, 5 or 10 minutes. And so and that's what won't happen in the life of the universe. Okay, FMEAs, we're not gonna go through these. When I do the class, we go through an example. Some of you folks may be familiar with them, some may not. The acronym stands for failure mode and effects analysis. It's a systematic method of taking a product and going through it from stem to stern and saying, if this part fails this way or that way or this other way, if this TCO fails open or fails short, what happens? What's the severity, the likelihood, and the detectability? And you go through this whole process, and to do a vacuum cleaner, which has no electronics in it and probably only a dozen parts that matter, can take 2 days. But you end up with a list of hundreds of failure modes, and you can rank them by the product of severity, likelihood, and detectability, and you rank them, and then you go through and you draw a cutoff and you fix everything above the cutoff. So it's a pretty good systematic way of finding things that you wouldn't have thought of otherwise. You know, the really weird failure modes where you go where one part fails and you get a cascading set of failures, especially that cross sort of design responsibility boundaries, where an electrical problem causes a mechanical problem, and neither the EE or the ME would have thought of it by himself, but together they do. So we won't go through it. It's a good replacement for Novocaine before root canal, but they're very useful. It's like cleaning out your garage. It's a great thing to do, but nobody wants to do it. Okay, reliability. So designing reliability into a product, reliability is often seen as a matter of luck. You know, it happens or it doesn't. Almost no one outside of medical or aerospace actually designs it into their product. But it's a discipline like any other, you know, just like electrical or mechanical engineering. And, you know, what an engineer does is use science to produce things within sets of constraints. You know, he has a cost budget, he has a weight and volume budget, he may have performance budgets of some time, power, waste heat, many other things. And he has to make the design work within those constraints. Quality and reliability are a set of budgets just like the others. It's just another set of constraints. And the way you achieve this is through a budgeting exercise. Just as at the beginning of the project, when you're building your design's vacuum cleaner, you say, I'm allowed to have a total COGS of $21. I'm going to break the money up, you know, $3 for this motor, $1 for the agitator motor, so much for this belt, this hose, this cord. And then you go through and you design it and you get quotes and you go back to your budget and adjust things and maybe go back and redesign other things to bring your total cost down. You do the same thing with failure budgeting. So we're designing this vacuum cleaner, and our accountants tell us we're allowed to have our rate of retail returns that's 4% in order to meet our financial goals. And so out of that 4%, I know from experience that 60% of the returns will not be defective. People are returning them because they don't like the color, or they decided they spent too much money, or they changed their mind, or whatever. So 2.4% come back regardless of the quality of the product. Well, that leaves you with 1.6% for actual defective returns. A third of those are going to be problems you never anticipated, no matter how hard you tried, because the customer is pretty inventive at figuring out how to mess up your product. I used to have to review all the call logs at EuroPro, and you wouldn't believe what some people do with vacuum cleaners. You give somebody a vacuum cleaner which has a cyclone separation chamber, and under that there's a HEPA filter, which is a piece of foam. And then there were two additional HEPA filters packaged in a cellophane bag. It says spare filters. And people open it up, take the two filters, jam them in on top of the other filter, jam the cyclone down. You know, you have to really be fairly strong to do this. Jam it together, and then wonder why it won't vacuum anything up. So you get to set aside a third, or 0.55% in this case, for the unanticipated problem. Some of the products will leave the factory already defective. And this is something called an acceptable quality level, and you negotiate it with the factory, and it's enshrined in the contract that you and the factory signed to produce the goods. And it's never zero, it can't be zero. If you want it to be really low, you have to pay a lot of money. And if you accept a higher number, you pay less. And you have to strike a balance depending on where you've positioned yourself in the market for the quality of your products. If you're some no-name manufacturing selling at Kmart, you're probably going to accept 1.5%. And if you're selling Mealy's, you're probably down at 0.1%. So in this example, let's say it's 0.65% for the AQL. The manufacturer can legally ship up to 0.65% of his output as defective, and you have no financial recourse. Now, other parts of the contract, he can't knowingly ship defective units, but some will get out anyways. And so there's 0.65% that you could have already be defective before the customer ever gets it. That leaves you with 0.4% for actual defects that occur during the warranty period. So where you said, you know, I'm allowing myself a 4% return rate, I'm actually only allowed to have a 0.4% defect rate. And that's what the engineers have to work with them when they design the product. because almost everything else is spoken for, is out of their hands. Any questions about this? This is one of the things that are really not intuitive, especially to startups. You know, they think a failure rate of 5% or 10% is fine, and the reality is 4%. And this is for the whole thing. So then you construct a budget. So I split that 0.4% up among all the parts of the product. And so I have a suction motor and a brush motor and a belt and a cord and a switch and a hose. And based on experience, and we usually actually have people vote on this. It works actually works pretty well, where people rank different parts or assign point values for different components by the likelihood of failure, and then we do a weighted average. So you're looking at something like, you know, you're at the suction motor, you're allowed to have 0.05% or 1 out of 2,000 fail in the warranty period. And this isn't, that motor might be built for less than a dollar. So this is where the where folks building consumer products, designing consumer products, earn their money, figuring out how to make a 50-cent motor last, you know, have a failure rate of 1 out of 2,000 with the abuse that people give it. So what you would then do is based on this information. Yep?
How common is it to separate out quality testing from the factory? Or if the factory supplies you stuff, how common is it to do like 100% testing on everything they do?
We'll talk about it in a little bit towards the end, so I'd like to save that question for later. Actually, no, let me just do it now, because I'll forget by then. In general, in production, as much as possible, you try for 100% coverage in testing. Not everything can be done 100% because it's destructive, or it's expensive or too time-consuming, or renders the product hard to sell. Like, you don't typically don't test a vacuum by vacuuming up actual dirt, because it would take you 20 hours to clean it out, make it look new again. So you have a lot of other proxy tests, but as much as possible, you try to test 100%. When you're building the very highest quality products at the very highest quality manufacturers, you actually start testing less, because your sub-vendors and the components they produce are so well designed and proven, and you have such a track record, you can now actually start cutting tests out, and you actually get a higher quality product, because every time you test, you run the risk of breaking something. So, but generally, you try for 100% coverage as much as possible, especially when you're dealing with your consumer products company. You design a vacuum cleaner, you're going to build it for a year and then never again. And so you're going to ramp it up quickly at this contract manufacturer in China. You're going to build 2 million units, and then you're going to throw it away. And so there, nobody ever gets to that level of quality where you can just assemble it. You're always testing everything, because you're always ramping up or ramping down.
Do you mean to say every product is tested before it leaves the factory?
Every product, it depends, but a vacuum cleaner like this, every major subassembly will have a couple of tests. Each of those motors will have voltage and current measured running free. The suction assembly will have another voltage and current measurement by itself. When it all goes together, there'll be a suction measurement down at the nozzle to detect leaks. And they'll also be measuring, again, current and voltage along the way. And so there'll be other tests too, as well, and there'll be a lot of inspections, probably a couple of dozen points, and that's just for an inexpensive vacuum cleaner.
And who does those tests?
The factory, there's different arrangements, but typically the contract manufacturer will do all those tests following a QC plan that the customer writes, or if they hire Dragon to do it, the Dragon writes, for example. And then, everything's got to pass this stuff 100%. Then it's all boxed up for shipment, and so a lot of 10,000 are ready to be shipped. Manufacturer will set it aside on an open space in the production floor, and then a representative of the customer, again, it could be Dragon, or you could hire SGS or Intertech, will come and take this and draw a sample from it. And they'll use a DoD Mill Standard 105 sampling plan. And so out of 10,000 units, they'll draw, I think, 120. And they'll inspect all 120, and they'll test all 120, and they may even do destructive testing to a few of them. And if they follow the mil-spec sampling procedure, then you're 80% confident that the shipment as a whole meets or exceeds the quality requirements. So it's belt and suspenders and a roll of duct tape besides. Because what you don't want is a shipment of 100,000 vacuum cleaners arrives in the U.S. and they're all defective because of some fundamental problem with a fixture. Because neither China Customs nor the factory wants to let them back into the country. And you got a big problem. It's in nobody's interest. So there's all these layers of testing. And the last one is essentially, it's like having a financial auditing firm come in and audit your books.
Have you been in a situation where you do a sampling and it fails the sample test?
Oh, sure. Then this is the contract with the manufacturer specifies that if it fails the sampling test and the AQLs and all the parameters of the test are in the contract, then the manufacturer is legally obligated to reinspect the entire lot, not just the ones that failed, and repair or replace anything they find. And then they put the lot together again, and it gets reinspected again. And if it fails, back it goes. And some contracts will say if you fail three times in a row, that lot has to be thrown away. And if that happens X times, the contract with the manufacturer can be canceled.
I imagine it's an extremely hard conversation.
Typically not, actually. These folks, one company we worked with, Kenyatta Industries, Kenyatta produced the third generation Roomba and the Scuba. And in a given year, Kenyatta produces about 2,000 different products for, I don't know, 40 or 50 different clients. Of those 2,000 products, 1,400 were new that year. I mean, 70% of their production is a one and done. Build the tooling, build the line, train the workers, build the fixtures, develop all the parameters, build 500,000 or a million products, throw everything away. Do it again the next year. These people set up so many products that their business is not so much manufacturing products, it's setting up assembly lines. And so it's inevitable that some of these are going to fail. And it's just part of the it's the cost of doing business. And they expect that there's, you know, no one's error rate is zero, not yours and not theirs. And so unless it's too high a level, you know, they understand. And actually in the early days at iRobot, we had rejected shipments an awful lot. And a lot of it were based on design issues. The design was just too shaky. And we were trying to fix it by tightening up the manufacturing standards, which didn't really work. Okay, just sort of one sidebar. Everyone's heard of Six Sigma. Almost nobody knows where it comes from or what it does. But it's an interesting concept. In the early days of building cell phones, Motorola had a lot of yield and quality problems, as everybody did at the time. And they said, what do we have to do so we can just assemble it and it will always work? Because when your yield is poor and you're doing repair and rework, it slows down the production line, costs a lot of money, your quality's poor, et cetera. And so they came up with the Six Sigma concept. And what they said was, if you have a component that has a certain standard deviation in whatever parameter you care about, if plus or minus six standard deviations of that fits within the actual range of values you need to make the product work, then you can build this cell phone if as long as all of the components follow the Six Sigma requirement. And you know, it'll just always go together, it'll always work. And so if you look at that like on a number line, what that says is, if I need a 100 ohm resistor and my testing or my circuit simulations say, you know, I can tolerate anywhere from 94 to 106, then if I take a large batch of these resistors and I test them and I get a, you know, bell curve like this, and it's, you know, six sigma on each side, in other words, the resistor has a resistance of 100 ohms and a standard deviation of 1 ohm, then I'm good. And so that was the rule that they followed. Six Sigma then turned into a whole body of statistical techniques and other things for process improvements. But that's basically what it is. Now, plus or minus Six Sigma says that, I think it's, is it half a part per billion? I wrote it down. Two parts per billion falls outside, so you have one part per billion here and one part per billion here. Those are really small numbers. And it tells you the vast majority of them are right here in the center. Now, you might say, what would happen instead if the resistors were not of as good quality, but we sorted them, we tested every resistor. So let's say that the bell curve would be like this, but we sort it and we cut it off here and here, right? So this is our distribution. Now in this case, almost all the resistors are here in the center. What about these? How many are the resistance values always going to be in the center here? No, a lot of them are going to be like over here. So you build this cell phone up and it's got, I don't know, 200 components in it. And a lot of them have values that are just barely good enough. How well is that cell phone going to work overall? Every component met the spec, but a lot of them were close to the edge.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult to do the statistical math with like the RSS on this, right? When you have an assembly of parts, and the parts have tolerance deviations, you do a root sum square to figure out what the.
But that's only true if it adds linearly, and in a lot of products, the way these components interact is way more complex than that.
Yeah.
So you can't just roll up the numbers, but just intuitively as an engineer, if I've got components that are only just barely good enough and I build a product out of it, is that product, how, you know, is one product to the next on the assembly line, are they going to be the same or are they going to be different? And are they all going to be long-lived or are some of them going to croak early?
Gut feel says you're worse off, obviously.
Yeah, it's and there's lots of good examples. Again, back in the mid-70s, back to the domestic versus Japanese automakers. So the Japanese bring in these inexpensive small cars, and people derided them as inexpensive pieces of junk, blah, blah, blah. And the years go by, and these inexpensive pieces of junk run 100,000 and 200,000 miles, and they just never freaking die. And meanwhile, the American cars are you know, senile at 100,000. And the American automakers realized they had a real issue here. You know, how can this smaller, cheaper product last so much longer? And so they bought a bunch of cars, and they started tearing them apart. And they would take, for example, their transmission, where the General Motors transmission would say, okay, the gear center distances in the transmission, which is a critical dimension, it has this tolerance, plus or minus so much. As long as you're inside, you're okay. So this is the distribution of gear center distances in a GM transmission. They threw away a lot of scrap when they filtered them. This is the Japanese transmission. They're like tightly clustered around the center of the range. The Japanese were just building it to much tighter tolerances. As a result, you got transmissions that were one after the other were all the same. They ran quietly. You know, they didn't wear out because you didn't have gears jammed together or teeth that barely overlapped. And so it's a great illustration of this. Another illustration is when I first came on board at iRobot, and we had I think it was the Roomba 2 we did this to, we were struggling to get the average life of the product up and to get the return rate down. And one of the things we did was monitor the defect rate at every major sub-assembly test station. There were, I think, 12. And we were in the 1 to 1.5 to 2% range of sub-assemblies. So you'd have a wheel module, you know, a vacuum cleaner sub-assembly or so on. And if they were outside the range, they would be scrapped. So we were kind of like this. And so what we did was we started doing what we called poor man's SPC, statistical process control, where we just said, okay, you now have a requirement to be below 1% in all stations. In any given shift, and we had two shifts a day on 6 production lines, any given shift, if you're over 1%, you have to analyze and break down every single defective unit, and you have to give me a corrective action plan by the next day. And we had Dan Long, whose nickname became Thermonuclear Dan for the effect he had on production floors, enforcing this. And it took a while to get Jetta to do this, but eventually we got the drumbeat going. We started fixing problems, and eventually we got them all down to 1%. And then we said, okay, the new rule was 0.5%. Then we went to 0.375%. I was going to go to 0.25%, but they were starting to push back at that point. During this time, we didn't make any design changes of the robot. It was all a matter of and gearbox center distances, and the gearbox was one of the critical ones, where they were at plus or minus 4 or 5 thou when it should have been plus or minus 1, for example. And we had multiple cavities of identical parts, multiple modes, and they were different one from the other. We went from an average product life of probably 400 or 500 hours to over 1,000 hours, and all we did was tighten up the tolerances. We didn't make any design changes. The motors were the same, the plastic materials were the same, you know, the workers were the same. We just tightened up tolerances, built better fixtures for assembling them, trained the workers. Soldering quality was a big problem, because as soon as you train a worker to solder well, they promptly quit and go to a factory down the street that'll pay more for a trained soldering technician. And so we had to get Jetta to pay the technicians more to keep them. And so that's another great example of how that strategy works. Okay, effective parts count and failure rates. We showed this a little bit when we looked at the failure budget for that vacuum cleaner. By the time you get to something that has hundreds or thousands of parts, the reliability you have down at the level of those individual parts goes into the parts per million or parts per billion range. And it's just something that is intuitively not obvious. And an engineer who doesn't have any experience will not make the right decisions because it just doesn't seem to make any sense. You ask him, this vacuum cleaner has to have a life of 600 hours. It has two motors in it. What's the motor life got to be? And he'll say, oh, 610 hours. No, the reality is got to be somewhere in the 1,200 to 1,800 to multiple thousands of hours because failure rates add. Okay. Another sort of corollary is that between the fact that the standards you have to meet being very strict and the time it takes to test to these standards very long. If you've got a product that should have 1,000 hours of life and you expect a failure rate of 0.4%, then I've got to test 250 of them for 1,000 hours to get one failure. You know, at one shift a day, 1,000 hours will take me 6 months, and 250 of them is a lot to test. You know, it was a huge effort to test as many as 150 robots at a time, and we had the factory's labor force to draw on. So most of the time, especially if you're a startup, any test you can actually afford to do shouldn't ever have any failures. And so it's a great rule of thumb for a startup developing something, which is all failures have to be fixed because of this. If you had any failure at all that in a test you could afford to do or had time to do, it was way too high a failure rate and you got to fix it. Okay, failure distributions, this is classic, I think everybody's seen it. You have a relatively high level of infant mortality failures when you first start out. Then you have occasional random failures at a constant rate during most of the life of the product. Then you have a wear out where everything just goes to heck. A great example would be, imagine brake pads for your car. So you've got a piece of formed steel, or you've got a brake pad material that's stuck on with glue or rivets or glue and rivets. And you may have some instances of infant mortality where the rivets were peened too hard and they cracked, and so the thing just strips off, or the glue was no good, or something like that. So hopefully a very small rate of very early failures. You get past that, and then while the brake pad material is wearing but still plenty thick, you're basically going to have no failures. Until the pad wears down to nothing, and then all of a sudden, you know, they go to heck all together. That said, in all the tests I've done and all the data I've collected, I've never actually seen this in my test data. It's always a nice smooth curve going up. So it's always been below the resolution I had in my tests of up to 150 units. Okay, early failures and late failures. Failures can be distributed different ways, and we won't get all technical about it, but MTBF, or product life, is what everyone wants to talk about. It's actually not that important, because for consumer products, for example, what you care about is warranty failures. And that's typically very early in the life of a product that the warranty goes by. And you can have two products, both of them have, say, a 500-hour life, same average life, but that one at the warranty period of 100 hours will have a failure rate of, say, 0.4%, and the other one could have a failure rate of 20%. Yet they both have an average life of 500 hours. Because one of them is actually a long-lived product with a high rate of early failures, where the failures tend to occur early and drop off. And the other, the more desirable one, will tend to have very few failures until the end when they occur all of a sudden. Like the brake pad example, most brake pads are just not going to fail until they wear out. Then they're all going to fail at very similar times. And this is important because a 20% defect rate is bankruptcy, and that's the end of your company, or at least the end of that product. Okay. And the difference between the early and the late failures, to some extent, can be a function of the materials. Solid-state devices tend to fail early, or at least to have what's known as a constant failure rate, whereas mechanical devices subject to wear out tend to have late failures. And to move from an early failure distribution to a late failure distribution is typically a matter of consistency and repeatability. It's not a matter of replacing steel with titanium or nickel with gold on contacts. It's a matter of getting the holes to line up, getting the tolerances right, just like we did at iRobot by driving the defect rate down, or the Japanese did with the transmission. They didn't make their transmissions out of diamond-coated moon rocks. They just made the tolerances real tight, and they made the dimensions good. And so that's another important takeaway lesson, is improving consistency and repeatability is usually the way to improve the quality of the product, and it's a lot cheaper than throwing money at gold or titanium. Okay, this is the end of the quality section. Questions before we take a break? Okay, do you want to take a break now? And then we'll come back and we'll finish the last part up on test design.